from Chicago, Kup Show with Irv Kupcinet.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the lively art of conversation, 1 hour of unrehearsed conversation, all extemporaneous and spontaneous. We have five delightful guests, all involved in the performing arts for you to meet. I'd like to introduce them to you now. First, this is Susan Strasberg. Susan is a member of an illustrious theatrical family headed by her father, Lee Strasberg, and she's created quite a stir with her new autobiography called Bittersweet. And next to her is one of the great film and stage actresses, Alexis Smith, Tony Award winner, and currently starring in the best Little Whorehouse in Texas at the Schubert Theater. Earl Blackwell, an authority on celebrities, he is the great moderator and the great determiner of who is a celebrity and who is not. He's founder and owner of the Celebrity Services, and he's just co-authored a book called Skyrocket. And here is one of the best-known authors of the day, Erich Segal. He skyrocketed to fame with his novel, Love Story. His third novel called Man, Woman, and Child. And this is Lanford Wilson. Mr. Wilson has been the recipient of any number of prizes of late. He won a Pulitzer Prize for Tally's Folly. He got 5 Tony nominations. And the show just won the New York Drama Circle Critic Award as the best play. And his Pulitzer Prize winning play, Tally's Folly, just opened at the Studebaker Theater. He point out that the New Life magazine, just out, has a lovely picture of you, Lanford. Yeah, makes only one mistake. It says you've written 30 plays, and I think you've written about 40 plays.
40, yeah.
Of course. Very few of which, I should point out, have been commercial successes, all artistic successes.
Absolutely.
Any reason why you can't be successful commercially and artistically?
Someone pointed out that I'm hitting once every 7 years, so it's like a locust cycle or something.
Well, yeah. Biblical, in other
right,
words.
Right, right. Once every 7 years, so I'll be back in 7 years to see you again.
Yeah. Right. Well, Tally's Folly is a
Tally's Folly is doing very well.
All the awards, my
right.
goodness.
That's a wonderful play.
Thank you.
As I look at this group, I'm reminded of something that Erich said, because each of you have had your ups and your downs, successes and failures. And Erich, you were quoted as saying that failure is easier to live with than success. In other words, let me put it the other way. Success is more difficult to live with than failure.
That's absolutely true.
Now, you had a meteoric rise. You became an overnight celebrity.
Fall.
Mr. Blackwell put you in his book right away, and after Love Story, and then you went into a tailspin.
Well, the simple fact is that if you are a failure, whether it's in a play or a movie or even a book, you disappear the next day. you're the next day's wrapping for garbage.
Wrapping.
Yes, I was about to say it. Thank you, Susan. They wrap garbage in whatever your reviews are. If you're a success, they follow you, they being the press, the predatory press, and they eat you alive. And it's very difficult to sustain success. Failure is easy because next case.
Because no one needs you.
No, although actually it's not just the press, though, I think. I read an article recently. It was talking about the fact that the stress of being successful is actually greater than the success of failing. Because what happens is you're so precariously balanced that you're constantly under your own need to maintain the position, which then stops you from living your life and going on. And that as long as when you're achieving, when you're reaching out, it's that thing of the Browning thing, a man's grasp must exceed his reach, or what's a heaven for, that once you get there, then you have to deal with, if the success doesn't also do the things for you that you expected it to do, which usually it doesn't do, mm-hmm. then you then have to deal with yourself.
If you're banging your head against against the wall of success all the way through your career, you're banging against this, and they're saying, no, you're terrible, you stink, go away, and you keep hitting it. Suddenly they say, oh, you're marvelous, and all the walls fly open, you just fall right through and say, now what do I do?
Well, I think it's easier, success. I really do.
It's more fun.
It's more
God
fun.
Knows.
It is, because you can relax and enjoy it. You cannot relax and enjoy failure.
I go back to work easier after failure.
I
can go back to work easier after failure.
Right. I agree.
Let me point out something in Erich's case. His success came so suddenly after Love Story that you couldn't even teach at Yale. I mean, you were bombarded with autograph seekers and fans and so forth, adulation.
In the classroom.
Could, yeah.
In the classroom.
Really? Success did impair your ability to cope.
Absolutely. And I really think that of all the people I know who are successes, they look back with nostalgia on the days when, in the days when they were eating ketchup sandwiches. And,
You know a lot of boring people.
Ketchup sandwiches.
I personally am nostalgic for the days when I was a struggling writer and a struggling teacher. It's something, you know, it's something to fight for. It's a mountain to climb. When you reach the top of the mountain, there's nowhere to go, but
there are other mountains.
But there is, if you make a new dream, you just have to, set a goal that takes you further than where you've gone.
Yeah, a larger goal, yeah.
Become an actress and write a book.
The late Joey Lewis, whom some of you may remember, put it more succinctly. He said, I've been rich and I've been poor. And I want you to know that rich is nicer.
Yes.
That has something to do with success and failure.
Right.
Yeah, I think so.
I got in a cab and the cab driver said, do you have something to do with that show? And I said, I wrote it. And this is in the New York show. And the cab driver put it so nice. He said, so, how does it feel to be rich and famous? And I was taken aback and I'm saying, well. And he says, better than poor and obscure, huh? Yes, probably it is.
You know, when I first came to New York at 23, I wrote a play. It starred Constance Collier.
Oh.
It was called Aries is Rising. It opened at the John Golden Theater. One of the critics said, big fat turkey wobbled on the stage of the Golden Theater last night, played a big fat egg. So that was my beginning.
Well, at least it was nowhere to go but up.
That's right.
But Eric, you have a peculiar relationship with the critics, though. They seem to take great delight in knocking you as a writer, despite your tremendous success in selling books.
Well, I wouldn't say despite, I would say because. And I'll accept it, because there are two kinds of critics. There are the critics that write in the newspapers and the critics that read your books. And if I had to choose, of course I don't have a choice, but I'm happy with the way my lot turned out, that the people enjoy reading what I write, and the critics enjoy writing and knocking what I write. It's better to be a popular success than a critical success.
I think
Lanford would agree with me.
But I've had a number of plays were very well received by the critics and no audience would go near it.
Yeah.
And I really felt that there was something wrong with the play, that the audience wasn't understanding it or getting it. And I'll keep working on that play to try to make it accessible.
That's all we do, clarify,
making it accessible without harming the integrity of the piece.
Yes, but I think immediately you start clarifying it to appeal to a vast audience. It'll be harmful to the...
Work at Circle Rep, and we only have 160 seats, so it can't be too
that's
vast.
That's not vast, no.
That's not
well,
vast.
But the point
What's
of
your
doing...
point, though, Alexis? Is
it? No, I do think that it is disturbing to the quality
and
the integrity of the piece, because if a company believes in a property and... has a preview, for example, and then all the helpful hints start coming in and saying to clarify it for the audience and that this is too obscure or that they would be more receptive to it then it eats away at the very foundation of it. I think you should have the courage to go with what you believe and rather than trying to television can appeal
it would take me several years to discover what it was I could do to something to clarify it and keep it and still keep the piece's integrity.
Yeah.
Right, but those out-of-town tryouts where the producer's secretary says, do this and you do that
and
overnight, that would terrify me.
Yes.
I don't know what you'd end up with by the time you finish.
We are in the performing arts, and you've got to have an audience.
And you've got to communicate.
That's right. I mean, it has to... reach people.
Oh, indeed, yes.
It's one thing to have an audience, however, and it's the other thing to have self-appointed critics, which is what the out-of-town experience is all about with a play. The improvements that must go into an out-of-town play, the producer's friend, the director's sister, your co-star's boyfriend, they all have comments, and everything is wrong with the play that's trying out. Right. And that's a terrible thing.
You know,
I've never done it, but it must be awful. My father went to this theater story.
My father went to the theater with Boris Aronson, famous set designer.
Oh, he's amazing.
And out of town. And, of course, you know, you don't wait in the theater till the end of the play after the first act. My father said to Boris, who's kind of a little eccentric, well, Boris, what do you think of the play? Boris said, oh, it's wonderful. It's so confused. So they came out after the second act, and my father said, well, Boris, what do you think now? And Boris said, not so good. It's clearing up.
Susan, as long as you brought up your illustrious father and the subject of quite a few pages in your book, everybody in the theater stands in awe
either pro or against your father as a great teacher. But in the book, you point out that he was not a particularly good father, that he didn't spend as much time with you and your brother as perhaps
actually,
he should have.
I was not rating him as a father. I mean, as just as I don't want the critics to rate me on a certain level, I would not, I hope that I would criticize my father. I hope that in the book, that I do not blame anything that happened to me in my life on my father or society or the men in my life. I tried to show my father as human because he's been presented in to the public and to so many other people as a genius, which I think he is. But people forget that behind the facade or behind the part of a person they deal with, behind all of us, is the same human universal experience that everyone else is going through. Perhaps it's a little more, I guess we do breathe slightly more rarefied air. My father was a very dedicated man who had a dream. Most people don't have that kind of dream. There were times when his family and the reality of living may have been less necessary and less important to him than the dream at that moment. So that, it was choices. I've seen that in my own life, you have to make priorities and choices. And
not the imperfect genius, as Cindy Adams called them in her book.
Well, the thing is that you can say, well, you weren't loved enough. Do you know anyone who, when they were young, had enough? I mean, people I seem to meet across the country are all, feed me, love me, love me. None of us had ideal experiences, but it seems to me that I was very fortunate. That it's a double-edged sword when you're a child of famous parents. You have a lot of advantages and you have disadvantages too, but that in the long run, the thing that sustained me through all the dark years of my life, through the drug experiences that I had, through the...
marriage.
A violent marriage, through the...
Richard Burton. Cary Grant.
Through the difficult... Well, it's true. You know, I happen to know those people, so they are the people I write about. I hope that it's not a celebrity book in the sense that you see them as human beings, that it isn't prurient or exploitative. But, I got more. I think the thing that sustained me and nourished me and enabled me to be here when people like Marilyn Monroe and Elvis Presley and Judy Garland burnt themselves out going through some of the experiences that I went through, I think were the things that my father and mother gave me that perhaps I didn't appreciate. You know, when you have a lot very early, you often don't, you don't see it in a way, maybe perhaps it takes the painful experiences to awaken you, to learn to count your blessings. My father once said that when someone asked him about my early success, if he thought that it would hurt me. And he said, well, I don't know. He said, maybe success is like a box of candy. A few pieces taste terrific, but the whole box in one sitting can make you sick.
Your folks did set a high standard. I remember the story that when you opened in the show on Broadway, your mother came back and said, don't touch me, you were terrible tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Words to that effect.
Mm-hmm.
And then your father later blamed her for letting you take the role or play it the way you did, whatever.
Right. Well, remember
and
that
living with that kind of pressure was
very difficult because, first of all, it was like, if you think of the doctors don't operate on their own children, and yet I had two parents who were in the same profession that I was, and when they criticized me or... which they had to do, I mean, I was there. It was a little bit like doctors operating on their own child, only I had no anesthetic. And I was also young, I was unable to deal with it. My mother, remember though, my mother took the responsibility not just for some of my performances, but for Marilyn Monroe's. She got very little credit for it. She didn't get credit. You notice that no one gave my mother credit when we were good.
Mm-hmm.
But the minute there were difficulties with Marilyn or with myself, everyone blamed my mother. And because she had given up her own life, which I think was a tragic mistake, she was a very talented lady who started to live through Marilyn and I. We became her children, in other words. And I see that with my 14-year-old. There's that danger of living out your unfulfilled dreams through your children. So that it was more important to her that we be good, that we fulfill for her. Also, I think... You know, people who say how horrible that she criticized me for a performance are the same people who would attack their child for not getting good grades on a report card. And what people don't realize is that in our family, the New York Times Review was our report card.
Sure.
They didn't care if I flunked English and math, which I did regularly. So that within the out of context, it seems like a terrible story, or that she was very harsh with me. But how often have you, I find myself yelling sometimes at my child or being very shrewish in an effort almost to protect her. It's as if I will tell you before someone else from the outside tells you and hurts you. It's funny, now that I have a teenage daughter, I have a lot more compassion for my mother.
Right.
Right. Let me turn to Alexis now. There's so many books written like Susan's book here about her broken marriages, her marriage, her romantic figures, her experiences with drugs and so forth. You couldn't write a book like that.
About broken marriages? No.
No.
Isn't that
marriage,
nice?
Drugs, you haven't gone through it. You've been most fortunate. You've never a hint of scandal in your life.
She's a smart lady. 34 years, is it? Yeah.
34 years.
Something like that.
A very successful career. Nobody pointing a finger at Alexis Smith for doing something wrong.
I've been very, very fortunate in my life, I must say.
Has it been an interesting life? How have you avoided all the pitfalls of the other actresses?
I don't know.
Where did you fail?
I would go back to parents again, and I think that certainly my background had a great deal to do with it, and I came from staunch Scotch Presbyterian stock, which when I was a teenager I rebelled against, of course, but at that time rebellion wasn't what it is today. It was just being annoyed that my dad wouldn't let me go out on dates until I was 16 and I was going to Hollywood High School. But I really do think that what they instilled in me has really protected me against a great deal of unhappiness and tragedy, possibly, in throughout my life.
Would such strict parents like you to be in a show with the word whorehouse in it?
I've wondered about that. That's funny. I really have. I wondered what my, you know, if my mother and father were to see it, what they would think about it. But actually, I consider it a very innocent show.
Oh, it's fun.
And certainly, there is some strong language in it, but in our permissive society today, it is indeed an innocent show, as opposed to what one can see on television.
Does the language bother you, Alexis, with your background?
It doesn't. No, it doesn't. And, you know,
some of the critics thought it was
We're going to have to. I know they do. Four-letter words do serve a very healthy function in our society, and we're going to have to invent new ones because it's true, because we all find ourselves using them now, and they've become quite ordinary, and we've assimilated them into our everyday vocabulary. So you have a new four-letter word?
In your defense, there's something that could answer every critic.
I was going to say,
in support. Or may I add, the notion of four-letter words are natural to almost everyone. Do you know where you hear the primmest of people uttering four-letter words that they perhaps are not even aware that they know? Try walking through the labor rooms of a hospital when women are in labor.
Oh,
you hear
syllables.
Four-letter words
and
if you made a tape recorder, recording
you
this for
the
women.
You could never play it on television.
Right. No, you played it for the women who were in labor. They say, I didn't say that. That's not me. That's somebody else. But it's really true. Mm-hmm. Deep inside, every prude is a good
four-letter word.
vocabulary that comes out because those words evoke the feelings that no other words can
exactly
evoke.
Exactly. They're very strong.
I feel very strong on that topic, that I don't believe that there are people who never, ever utter those words.
No, they're very strong, and they serve a very good purpose, a very healthy purpose.
For a very
purpose.
Good release from time to time.
Yes, indeed.
It's
true.
That sometimes they become such common fodder that it's almost too much. I find myself, or I did at a certain period, I was living in California, and people a little more laid back and a lot of use of scatological language. It seemed to me that I was suddenly peppering my conversations with words because I was too lazy to look for another word. And that with me, I think a lot of people use them not because it's a release. I mean, it's one thing if you're angry and you're but a lot of people use four-letter words as a facade, as a defense. I noticed myself doing that. I stopped it a few years ago. My daughter said, Mother, why are you always, you're not even angry, why are you cursing?
And exactly.
I said, I have a very conservative daughter.
Well, that's where we have assimilated it into our language, where they
I was trying to be it was sophisticated.
Yeah.
And listen, I couldn't
Another
smoke when I was 14,
language,
I was now trying to curse.
But you said something, Susan, that I couldn't agree with more, and that is the fact that many writers and many people use those words because they're too lazy. to find other words.
Or a paucity of language, you know.
There are other words that can express the same feeling.
What did you just say? A lack in one's vocabulary, mm-hmm. where I think in many instances today, I walk down a street, mm-hmm. as I did recently in Detroit, and hear teenagers, and maybe every fourth word is a four-letter word, and I doubt that they have... you know, any other source to draw upon?
Well, they're certainly not developing an interesting vocabulary.
It's boring finally when it's overused.
Well, it's just tedious. They're not learning how to speak.
Exactly.
Susan, in your book, you say you don't tell all, or you say, in an interview, I think, you don't tell all the details about your unfortunate marriage to Mr. Jones.
I don't tell all the details about everything. I still want to have friends after the book came out.
Why did you hold back when you told so much about your relationship with Richard Burton?
I left things out all through the book about people, not just about my ex-husband. I guess, you know, it's funny, the person I was most concerned with reading this book was my daughter. She, being wiser than I gave her a copy when it came out, and I kind of warned her.
Has she read it?
No, she said she felt she wasn't ready to read some of the things that were in it. She also said, listen, Mother, now that you've blabbed your life story to the world, please try not to embarrass me anymore. But... it's interesting because she was very disturbed about the fact that I was writing. She said, well, do you want people to know about these things? And I'm not sure I want people to know about me. And I said, you know, somewhere all across America, there are people that are possibly going through the same kind of experiences that you and I went through, your heart surgery, things like that, the drug experiences that I had, who feel that there's no hope for them. And if writing about it can help somebody else to avoid those pitfalls, wouldn't that be a nice feeling to be able to touch people you can't see? And she said, I never thought of it that way. She said, well, I guess you can write about me in the book, she said, and you can make a movie of it as long as Tatum O'Neill doesn't play me. So she's very realistic.
Wide beyond her years.
I'll tell you, with my ex-husband, first of all, the more recent the things became in the book, the more difficult it was to write about them, because it seems to, I don't write, for instance, the last 5 years of my life are no one's business. It seems to me that you don't assimilate those experiences. It takes a long time to digest what's happened to me in the past 5 or 8 years. That's private territory. The marriage was the most recent thing that happened to me. Also, I told what I needed to tell to show. This was not a book about Christopher or about Richard Burton. It was a book about me, so that I felt more entitled to reveal certain things about me. I tried to show the other people in a more objective light as they were catalysts in my life, as they moved me forward, but not just to be gossipy. I mean, I know wonderful stories about a lot of people in Hollywood that I would not have thought of putting in this book. They don't belong there. They're not my stories. I in a way, have no right to them. You know, Christopher has a whole life that's his own.
Let me ask Alexis and Lanford about your dad, who brought a new form of acting and divided the acting
wasn't
world
really new,
under tremendous
though.
Well, he brought it into prominence,
yes.
Anyway, how about your actors? Are you happy when they are students of Strasberg, or do you like the other school, which doesn't believe in the motivation that he emphasized?
I'm not really quite sure what Sandy Meiser's relationship is.
It's the same base.
I was at the Actor's Studio as a writer for a while, and it was just one of the most thrilling times I've ever spent. We find that the actors that we use, because we're interested in the same approach to acting, over and over again, they have either studio training or the neighborhood playhouse training.
Mm-hmm.
If we like them, because we're interested in very real, very very honest,
full.
Very full, yeah. And so we have a very small theater, and if you're lying or faking, you're this far away, and you can tell. And he's just, as everyone knows, just an extraordinarily important force. And
look at the actors.
There's no question, but there's
also
a lot of actors who take issue with him.
Right.
Take issue with
very
him.
Very few,
but
actually.
I don't think the issue should
very
be
few.
With him, but with the actors.
Right.
Exactly. Some
themselves,
of the people who have
because
half understood
there are a lot of actors who perhaps have never set foot in the studio.
Exactly.
Who talk about being a
right.
in quote method actor,
right.
and who hide behind it and use
that's
it
right.
in a manner which it was never intended
look
to be
at,
used.
Look at the actors. I mean, look at what we. My father. It wasn't my father. He never claims that he made anyone talented, just that he tries to develop it. But if you look at your Academy Awards this year, they're all top professionals, not one mumbles or wears a t-shirt. That came from Marlon being so wonderful and Stanley Kowalski that everyone thought it was him, including him, I think, sometimes.
Sometimes.
But I mean, if you look at Jane Fonda and Jill Clayburgh and Sally Field and Bobby De Niro and Pacino and Dustin Hoffman and Walter Matthau and Elaine May, people that you don't think of as being students of his. And it's interesting because even people who have felt that they had to go out on their own have come back over the years. 20 years later, they'll show, I think, Anne Bancroft recently.
But you can run down a similar list of great names who say they don't believe in that kind of acting. That it,
listen, whatever works is terrific. If you told me that you stood on your head and turned and spit into the wind before you went on stage and you were wonderful, I would probably try it. I'm willing to try anything.
Exactly.
But a lot of actors, there are also a lot of actors who say, don't study. I want to be a raw, natural talent. That. Acting is the only profession that somebody would get up on would get up in front of an audience and do that has no exercises. It's the only art that has, you know, a ballet dancer wouldn't do it, a musician wouldn't do it. And why people suppose that actors should just get up and be these raw, natural talents, I find that very denigrating to the art.
No, but because our tool is our body, and it's something we have lived with all our lives. And as an actor, you walk and talk. Mm-hmm. And they think, well, I've been walking and talking.
It's not so easy.
You know, walking and talking all my life, therefore I can do it. And consider that it doesn't, that one doesn't have to hone and work and work and study, I mean, any more than a because the instrument is your body,
that's right.
As opposed to a piano or an easel and a palette.
When you see the really wonderful people back in class
that's right.
All the time, it's.
But
it's
then people who have never gone to the studio, who have never studied, but they do develop and develop
a way,
and hone
right.
away and
often it might be exactly the same thing. They may be putting down. The
do you
method,
know,
forgive that, completely. And they may inside be doing
exactly the same thing. They're doing it anyway. They're using it.
I once read for George Cukor, who I think is one of the most enchanting men in the world and a great director. And he was a good friend of my mother's and had known her for years. And I went to read for a play for him, and he said to me, now, Susan, I don't want any of that method.
Yeah.
Junk.
Since we've been talking
yes.
about four-letter words, junk. And he said, all I want you to do, he said, I don't want you to read the lines. I want you to read the thought behind the lines. I said, oh, you mean that method joke?
That method joke,
exactly.
Which is what that
someone
is.
It's what acting is
George
about.
George Cukor said that, which just shows that there have been such tremendous misconceptions. My father's writing a book now, which I think is vitally important because he has been so misunderstood, and misinterpreted. You know, he became famous and infamous at the same time. I guess anyone, that once you're set up there, you're also available for pot shots being taken
Fame
at you.
With due respect, I was just going to say that the other school of acting is the Spencer Tracy school of acting. Someone asked the great Mr. Tracy what the great art of acting was, and he said, remember your lines and don't bump into the furniture.
No,
yeah, and if ever there was a method actor, if you want to use the term, it was Spencer
That's
Tracy.
Right. You know, the sad thing to me about actors, for instance, like someone like Tracy, and even I'm not sure about Marlon, I think, is that they were slightly ashamed of being actors,
That's true,
if it was not an honorable profession.
For a man.
For a man.
Yes.
As if
yes.
show the emotion, to be vulnerable, was not quite the thing to be done. I mean,
A lot of actors still make that mistake.
Isn't that
yes.
so? Yeah.
Exactly.
Really
you find
sad.
Them turning into directors as soon as they possibly can, as though they had learned everything that there was to learn about acting and had to go on to something better. There's nothing better.
Writing.
Acting is astonishing.
Have
of course, we always
have.
You
of course, he has.
A couple of times.
But yeah.
I know.
Good. It's so to really act is really difficult. I mean, to really.
Except that you
leave yourself alone on stage and trust things
is wonderful.
Oh boy,
Except
is that hard.
Except that someone has
Fun.
To want you to act. Somebody has to. Ask you to do it, and they don't have to ask you to write. You can do that for yourself.
Well, there's that. Yes.
There is something humiliating about being 40 years old and waiting for
waiting
a producer
for
to call like an adolescent girl, waiting for the phone to ring.
Of course.
It's an untenable situation to be in sometimes. Yeah. There are moments when I say, why am I doing this? When I get up on stage, I say, this is why I'm doing it.
But you and our famous author here both have exclaimed or stated that you both fear you've run out of words. You both fear that you've run out of talent. You've said that, I know, on occasion, and I know you have, Lanford. You feel that way today with all your successes?
I feel that way when I'm not working. When I'm in the middle of something, I say, oh my goodness, wait till you see, this one is just going to be wonderful. Right now, I haven't had a chance to get back home and get down to the typewriter and pull the plug on the telephone and lock the door. And so I say, I have no idea if anything else is going to happen. Where are you?
Well, I think it's a common writer's neurosis that if you're into something in the day, you don't want the day to end. If you've got a good chapter or a good act or a good scene, you say, please God, give me the strength to finish the scene before darkness comes or before I collapse. Mm-hmm. Because there is the fear. Now, I don't know whether it's shared by every writer, but I know it's shared by many, that you're going to wake up in the morning and it's going to be all gone.
Going to be taken away.
There it is, another neurotic or another writer.
Right, exactly.
It's the same fear that you're going to lose it. Your characters will go.
And I swear I have no idea. Someone says, oh, that talent for writing is so interesting. Where does it come from? I have no idea. I can sit at the typewriter for 3 weeks and do nothing.
Huh.
And one day, you
comes
know.
Comes through.
Yeah, one day the muse comes back from Bermuda where she was living with someone's chauffeur and tells you what to say.
And you don't know where it comes from. There's a curious thing, which is that why do, when the comedy tells us, the theory of comedy tells us, that one of the important elements of comedy is surprise.
Mm-hmm.
The punchline must be a surprise. Why is it that writers, when they write a funny line, laugh at their own jokes?
Do you?
Oh, yes.
Oh,
don't
yes.
you?
Do
yes.
you?
Now, the answer is that obviously they didn't know it the minute before they wrote it.
Uh-huh.
It's a surprise to them.
Of course it is.
So André Gide, the great French writer, said there is a part of every writer, even a crummy writer, he didn't say crummy.
Mm-hmm.
he said there's a part of every writer that belongs to God. And there are some punchlines, and I don't want to cheapen your writing by saying you write punchlines, but there are
punchlines.
Great lines that come and they entertain you.
Oh,
first,
yes.
You're the
yes.
first
just
audience.
Delight you.
And it's a wonderful experience.
It's marvelous to surprise yourself when you're working.
That's lovely. Yeah.
It is
it's more surprising
thing.
When you think a line is funny, but your readers don't.
In acting. So
but you don't know that, you see, whether the readers do or not. You don't get that.
Well, you find out eventually.
Yes, but I mean on a particular reaction to a particular line, which is what we experience mm-hmm. in the theater, where we know whether they think it's funny
yeah.
or not immediately.
Immediately,
yes.
Eric, when in Love Story, when you had to kill your heroine, when she had to die, were you mm-hmm. sad the day that you wrote that?
I cried.
Oh, of course.
I know. I know. People think it was.
Some people say you're still looking for Jenny. Is that right?
Still looking for Jenny. She's dead.
Yeah.
I'm grieving for Jenny because I felt her death. And I feel her loss, because she was real to me while I wrote about her. And
Virginia
I cried.
And I did the same thing with Crystal Clear, our first novel together. The day that we had to kill the grandmother, I mean, she had to die in the Berlin crash, we were sad all day.
And
you know, it really disturbed us, because we had created that grandmother, and we loved her
Your
dearly.
Children.
And we knew that day she had to go in the bombing of Berlin.
Did you have funeral services?
No.
Eric, in your new book, you leave the ending ambiguously, and I presume you did that purposely because I see a sequel coming.
No.
But you have this young boy who was found out and who lives in France, and his mother dies, and
no, I haven't had a chance to finish this book yet. Don't tell me.
One of the characters is the father, brought to this country to live with his family, and then you leave the ending very ambiguous. He goes back after a visit here. Why did you end it that way?
Well, I have a tendency.
Have
I guess,
made it clear to the readers what your story is all about?
Yes, better than I could myself. Writers are notoriously bad at summarizing their own stories.
Yeah.
Man, Woman, and Child end sadly, but ambiguously, because I tend to use this is a paradox, to use sadness to emphasize the joy in life. The love of Oliver and Jenny in Love Story is underlined and underscored by the fact that Jenny dies and he loses all this love. At the end of Man, Woman, and Child, when the father has to say goodbye to his son, you feel his love all the more because he grieves for the loss of his son. And as far as a sequel is concerned...
But there is no loss. He's just going back. You don't know whether he comes
never
back.
Never going to see him again.
Well, you can't tell that from the book.
I don't want to hear that. How
never
do you know?
Never
going to
see him again.
Yeah. Are you sure?
Maybe that muse is going to fool you.
You mean you're not going to bring him back in the sequel?
I'll have to change
endings.
My name to Eric Sequel.
Oh.
I won't do it. That's a terrible joke. I won't use it. And you'll snip it out of this tape recording. No, but there's something about the unresolved. There's an, what's it called, that cadence in music that is unresolved?
The question is moot.
Right. That's let's leave it moot. But or mute. But But the most important thing is that people feel. And everybody writes his own ending to Man, Woman, and Child. Some people say, insist, they tell me, oh, the father's going to see the son again. I say, well, no, he's not. They say, well, you don't know what you're talking about.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that's the wonderful thing about creating a character.
Because you've created someone so real that they hope for and live with. Yes,
but I often wonder if it is not that unresolved ending, is that the author, I suspect at times, that the author couldn't come up with a third act.
That's right.
And yes. And that it was not a choice of a conscious choice, as yours is. I mean, truly a conscious choice. It was a lack of talent, really, and that they could not resolve it in a manner that was fitting to the...
Sometimes there's more resonance in an unresolved ending. Sometimes
there is. Sometimes unresolved, but sad. I would almost rather have unresolved than sad endings. I think I guess I'm a terminal romantic, and I really would like to have happy endings. I think we deserve.
This is both. This is unresolved and sad, because the young boy.
Yes, but he doesn't really know.
Look, it's so easy to write a happy ending. That's the point. You could
really. You have to earn a sad ending.
It's one of the pleasures. Yes. One of the few pleasures I had of the success of Love Story was that it was parodied so many times. Mm-hmm. And one of the parodies was. The New York Times printed it, some comic piece about what would have happened had Jenny lived and not died. And it was sort of hilarious at the same time. It was silly. I mean, she was there 400 pounds cooking spaghetti for Oliver coming home from the office. And it was just another story. The whole point of, I mean, every author has a choice. You can have a happy ending or a sad ending. Shakespeare could have had Romeo and Juliet live. And as a fact, let me just finish with this real professorial note. In every version of Hamlet, but the one William Shakespeare wrote, Hamlet lives. Hmm. Put that in your pipe and smoke it.
Isn't that amazing?
Only Shakespeare kills Hamlet.
And justifiably.
Justifiable homicide. Why?
Earl, you're sitting here with four very prominent people. Do they all qualify for celebrityhood? And what are the qualifications for celebrityhood?
It's someone who's, I think, a real celebrity is someone whose name needs no qualification. If you say Susan Strasberg, you don't have to say actress. Now you say author, too. And with Alexis and with Eric, and now with Rabbit, who's just going to be in the new celebrity register after winning the Pulitzer Prize. But you know, what's interesting about fame, we do a celebrity register every 7 or 8 years. Now you think 5 years ago, it's the last register, 7 years ago, James Earl Carter was not in. James Earl Carter, since he has become President of the United States, Jimmy Carter, has created celebrities. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting how one celebrity will create another.
Is there a large turnover in the books, let's say, in these 7 years? Oh, there is.
Tremendous.
Earl, you know, it would be fascinating to go. How many years have you done it?
I've done it now for four registers.
Would be
and
interesting.
And I've had celebrity register, I mean,
so that's what,
years.
40?
How many?
25 years?
Yes, 25 years. I've had the service longer.
To do
years.
A piece on the turnover and the people who have sustained and throughout.
Whatever happened to.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, some will go on forever. And think of Mary Pickford. She was in the beginning until her death.
Right.
Is she the longest time celebrity you've had?
Probably. Well, Gloria Swanson is another. Lillian Gish is certainly another.
Do they have to be in the performing arts or have that
knowledge? Jimmy Carter's not the performing
arts. Jimmy Carter, of course, will
be as long as he lived, be a celebrity. Now, once you're the President of the United States, you'll retain that, certainly.
Oh, of course.
That's right.
Richard Nixon will, even after his...
It's interesting in your new book, Skyrocket, that you have a broadcaster who wants to get into politics. And just recently, we had the story... was a kind of a gag about Walter Cronkite becoming a vice presidential candidate for Anderson.
Well, you know, Cap, we wrote...
And they both came to the same conclusion. Cronkite said that journalism and politics don't belong together, and he had no intention of running. And your candidate, your man, also takes the same position.
Yes, Skyler Madison, we wrote this a year and a half ago, and we have our hero, the beginning of the book. He's a newscaster, well-respected and admired throughout the country. And they come to him wanting him to run for the governor of New York and on to the White House. And then we flash back through his life as a young boy. And he has only one reason for doubting whether he should go, is powerful newspaper chain or would be against him. And the girl he's fallen in love with and had an affair with throughout the book owns the newspaper chain. So we wonder if she will back him or not back him. That's more or less the book. But when we read about Walter Cronkite being asked to perhaps be vice president, we thought, how extraordinary.
He must have read your book. Yeah.
Someone
life
read it.
Life imitates art. A life is always a step behind art.
Yeah.
There are things that are so extraordinary when you start talking to people. And so I know people said to me, your book's like a soap opera. My publisher at one point said, you have to change. The first page is kind of a litany of some of the tragic things that happened within a 5-week period. She said, you have to cut some of them out. I said, but it's my life. That's the way it happened. She said, nobody will believe it. And I find that it is extraordinary talking to people going around the country. I mean, the human spirit is a lot stronger, I think, than people appreciate. I don't know how people survive the amazing, some traumatic, difficult things that happen. We all are, in a way, living our own soap operas. Classy ones, I hope.
Right.
But
Alexis, you've had a very interesting career, and now some of the newspapers, in summing up your career, say you've started a second career now. Do you look upon it that way, as a second career after your motion picture career?
No, I don't. Well, I don't look upon it in retrospect, actually, because I'm not interested in
looking back
at all.
That's terrific.
Yeah. And
that's way to live.
I'm working happily and enjoying it thoroughly, and it matters not. Those are concerns of other people, of interviews or whatever.
Yeah.
It is not a concern of mine. And. I thoroughly enjoy working in the theater, certainly. And if I do think about it, I've been most fortunate. But I think it's a process of a result of an insatiable curiosity, which I have, which leads me to all kinds of pursuits and studies and an interest in the art, which is never failing. And so I'm constantly productive. And as a result, personally, and as a result, I think, that kind of productivity puts me in good stead when a job comes along.
Are you happy doing a musical, whereas you did not do many musicals as an actress? You were doing either in motion pictures.
I know.
Didn't get many musicals.
No, and I wanted to much, but and I used to run around and say, please, I know how to dance, and I would like to do a musical. But then at that point in films, they were always cute little girls, mm-hmm. and I happily have never been a cute little girl, so they didn't think of me.
You're a big girl.
Thank you.
It's very interesting, Lanford, that you are now writing two-character plays. The last couple of plays have been two-character. Have you fallen into this by...
No, I'm not going to write another two-character play.
Your new one coming up.
The new one has eight or nine.
Is a two-character play.
This one that opened last night, it's a two-character play, right?
Yeah.
But the next one has 8 or 9 characters in it.
Two-actor plays have been very economical to produce today in a world where finances is dictating a good deal of what's happening in the theater.
It had nothing to do with why I did it, of course, but I see that that's true now, and I'm perfectly happy to accept the royalties from every company that wants to do it. But I wanted to see what a two-character play was like and how difficult it was. Also, I wrote a two-character television show, and it was twisted around so much and cut so badly and everything. I wanted to do one where I had the control of it, and we could put it on at our theater, and it wouldn't be changed.
Mm-hmm. I'm just fascinated by your impressions of Marilyn Monroe. We just saw her on television, we saw her life, part of her life on television. A big movie is coming up on Marilyn. Now, you knew Marilyn very well. We practically lived together while she was a student of your father's. And what impressions do you have of Marilyn and the public's interpretation of her?
First of all, she was a much brighter woman, I think, than people realize. I mean, all those things people think press agents made up, she said. I'll never forget the thing. She's
bright.
Very, very fast. It was street smart, but she was also, remember, it's not in the book, but she was, she was at a party that someone had given for me. And it was after the McCarthy period, and two of the people who had not spoken to each other for many years, they had been on opposite sides of the fence, started talking, and someone who was with us turned to Marilyn and said, oh, look, Marilyn, so-and-so and so-and-so have buried the hatchet. And she said, yeah, but what worries me is in whom. As it turned out, it was in her, but I didn't put it in the book because it again is gossip. I didn't want it to it was two people that were close to her, but she, you know, it was strange because she did have that, I mean it wasn't schizophrenic, but she did have that ability, talk about it in the book, to turn on that public personality.
Yeah.
And in a way, I think that's sad, because I think that's probably what disturbed her life so much. In other words, I would hope that I am very much, at this point in my life, certainly, I don't have a public personality any longer. I think when I was younger, I did. I tried to fit into a certain image because I was so concerned about destroying. But Marilyn, we would walk down the street and no one would notice her. And yet she could say to you, now, do you want to see me be her? And she would, if it's true that stars have their own inner light, right, she would turn it on and she would shift imperceptibly some kind of inner gear. And suddenly people say, oh, it's Marilyn Monroe, it's Marilyn Monroe. And she would kind of smile, this wicked little smile that I don't know. I've tried it sometimes. It doesn't work.
Did you know her, Alexis?
No, I didn't. I met her once. But
I know you worked with Errol Flynn. Can you believe the current
that
story
Errol Flynn
that
was
Errol Flynn was a Nazi spy?
I just think it's so funny, because if
too.
He were, he certainly wouldn't have gone around telling people, you know, and everyone is asking all his friends
know,
and
right?
wives and things, do you think he was? So if he were a successful one, no one would know, right?
Well, I think it's true, because the Nazis lost the war. That was typical of Errol Flynn's ability to think beyond the next movie.
He was
movie.
Certainly a very, you were talking about Marilyn Monroe being mm-hmm. a very bright lady. Errol was certainly a very bright man, and the general public, I don't think, ever
no.
thought of him as
very
that.
Very destructive, wasn't he? Like Marilyn, who I think was
I
very
don't
destructive.
Know that it was destructive. I remember we were doing a film called Gentleman Jim, and he was in his early or mid-30s at that mm-hmm. time, and had a heart attack, a very mild one, but no one knew it because the studio didn't want it to be known. And I went to him and said, this is perfectly ridiculous at your age to have a heart attack. You should take better care of yourself, mm-hmm. and don't you want to live to a ripe old age? He said, no. He said, I'm only interested in this half, and I want to live it my way and to the fullest, and the rest of it I don't care about. And that's exactly what he did.
Mm-hmm. My last reminiscence of Errol Flynn was when Cuba went communism, when Castro took over. Mm-hmm. I was down covering the story, and who was there but Errol Flynn? Fat, mm-hmm. unshaven, drinking, trying to make some kind of a deal to get in with Castro. Such a pitiful sight. I really felt so sad for him.
Well, that's for a Nazi spy. That wasn't yeah. wasn't too bright, was it?
That's like a choice. Pick either side.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
Susan, you said you wrote your book to discover yourself. Did you discover yourself in the book?
Well, you know, I wrote the book part, one
you
of the reasons.
Seeking your identity.
No, one of the, phrase. Not really, you know, in a way, it's something Alexis said about, you know, not looking back. Although I think it was Plato, I'm about to misquote Plato. If there is a classicist, please correct me. But what was the thing he said about an unexamined life? Is it
Socrates? Socrates.
No, it was Plato.
Socrates quoting Plato. The unexamined life is not worth living.
It's not worth living. So I was coming up to 40, and it seemed to me it was time, because I had been through so much, and I guess I had lived in the fast lane for a long time, lived on the mountains and the valleys, and now I was trying to find some kind of middle ground for myself, that I look back, but I look back not to hang on to it, but in order that I could go forward without having to look back any longer. I think if you don't live, you know, for half my life I lived worrying about the past and anticipating the future, and I want to live now.
It's the only
I think is the only way to do it, and you learn from your past mistakes and then let go of it. I thought I would find answers, I think, whose fault it was. Was, you know, were there heroes or villains? And what I found is I don't think there are any answers. I think there are a lot of very good questions which you ask, but that you never arrive at. I hope that when they're putting me into the grave, well, I want to be cremated, when they're scattering me to the wind, I'll still be saying, wait a minute, I'm not ready yet. I want to find out more. It's the thing that Alexis was saying about, that she is, by the way, I think you are terrific. I've always admired you.
Thank you.
And she has something that I think many artists have, and we're blessed with it, is this sense, scientists have it too, this sense of wonder and adventure about
yes.
life.
Yeah.
And right. it's not, by the way, it's not, a lot of people say, well, artists are childish. They're not. They're childlike. The best part of the child is that wonderment. Bronowski said, what is it? Life is a great adventure lived on the edge of uncertainty. And we don't appreciate it all the time. I didn't, but I do now. And the book helped me in that, and hopefully will help someone else.
Alfred Hitchcock said all actors and actresses are childs.
He said it with a smile.
He also said he envied Walt Disney, because if he didn't like an actor, he could tear him up.
Yes. And he could also make Lassie act.
Some directors do that with actors anyway.
I know, live. Mm. Yeah.
Eric, are you working on a sequel now? Let me go back to that for just a moment.
Well, Man, Woman, and Child was so hard to write that the end of it is the end of my involvement with these characters. Lanford will agree to this notion that when you play yourself out emotionally with characters and you reach the last act, there are no sequels.
That's
in the
it.
Theater.
Yes.
And Man, Woman, and Child, in a sense, is one scene. It's a scene of a man having to tell his wife that he has a child by someone else and finding out whether this child can fit in the family. There can be no sequels. That's it.
So you're writing a completely different book now.
Mm. When I find the courage.
When you find and
the courage?
Tomorrow.
When I find the courage. Tomorrow. Never, not tomorrow.
Yes, you never know. Don't
ask
you
me tomorrow
anticipate.
Morning.
Yeah,
but you don't
doesn't
know.
Feel like it today.
Sure. Alexis, you said something that kind of sums up your profession so well. That when you're making a lot of money, you're so busy working, you don't have time to spend it.
Yes.
And when you're not working, you're always afraid that you're going
you'll
to
never
run out
get
of
another
money.
Job. Yeah. No, so you better say, yeah, it's true.
The life of an actress and an actor is so, so.
I think all actors feel that way. When you're working, you think it's going to last forever, and the moment the show closes or the picture finishes, you think, oh my God, I'll never get another job. Yes.
And I go 6 months and say, maybe I've forgotten how to.
Exactly. Oh, yes.
Which is terrifying, the first time you get back up on stage after a long time. How did I do it? What did I do?
But it's every experience, every job is a totally new experience, which is what's wonderful about our profession, I think. New people.
The most interesting people in the
world. Yes, yes. Actors are the best. They really are.
I don't know if they're better than
Actors
and writers.
Painters and the whole
writers.
Yes, artists.
Everybody is a ham, so I include you in that, too.
You.
Earl?
Some people are hams, some people are tongues.
You said that tongue-in-cheek, I hope.
No, the
tongue-in-cheek. One of your taglines that you laugh at a lot, right?
No. I just came up with it. It didn't float, so it will never be heard
again. You're not going to use that.
Also, will be bleeped from the segment.
Earl, you have a committee or somebody who helps you determine who celebrities are, how they qualify?
No, I have a committee. Yes, who check on the files of people, what they've written, how their books, if they've been a bestseller. It's usually the news media that decide who is really a celebrity and who isn't. But you know, hearing...
A lot of people get a lot of press for negative things. They become famous for the wrong things. Can they become celebrities?
Of course.
They can.
Unfortunately, yes.
I mean, notoriety is equated with fame.
Creates fame. And it's interesting how some people make other people famous. I was saying a moment ago, Grace Kelly was a movie star. Mm-hmm. And she married a royal prince who was practically unknown. Mm-hmm. And Rainier became an international celebrity. So one celebrity makes another celebrity.
In this age of egalitarianism, is there any interest in celebrityhood still?
Well, of course.
There is.
Oh, look at every television show, every newspaper. They all need celebrities. Look at the people pages practically of all newspapers today. They have a people page.
New York
page.
Times has one, too.
They have one now.
You consider those celebrities, though,
of
by
course.
Your classification.
Of course. You know, I was listening to Eric, though, and Babbitt speaking about writing. I've been lucky to collaborate with a very good writer, Eugenia Shepherd.
Yes.
And we've written two books, and we've started a third.
That's true.
So we really enjoyed writing together.
Does her fashion rub off on you? Eugenia's a famous fashion writer.
That's right. But she's always wanted to write. Mm-hmm. She, as a little girl, she tells me, she wrote little stories, but she didn't know about plots, and luckily I'm a very good plot man, a character man, so that's how we collaborate. And we hit back and forth the ball, and I'm sure sitting in a corner lonely with a typewriter, as you both described, must be very difficult. But we sit each morning and decide what we're going to write that day and discuss it thoroughly. Then I will go away and Eugenia will write. Then I edit each page as she turns it out. And we have a wonderful collaboration and enjoy it very much.
As a writer myself, I think collaboration would be the most difficult form of writing. I couldn't imagine it. Can you, Lanford?
No, I can't.
It's very difficult.
I'm sitting saying that, must be,
it's
so,
such a personal
that
thing.
Must be so wonderful to have that kind of relationship with someone where you can work together like that. I couldn't possibly, except, of course, playwrights have to collaborate with with artists and designers and directors and actors and
team ball playing. Yes.
That is,
yeah, but it's different,
yeah, it that's thrilling to me. That's just very
you
exciting.
Mean while you're writing, you collaborate with those people.
No, during the rehearsal, and of course you're changing some things while in rehearsal. But no, I can't imagine. I'd like to do a musical someday.
Eric is ready.
Eric, you want to do a musical?
I'm looking forward to working with a songwriter.
No, you're not.
Yes.
No way. No way.
May I
please quote an anecdote? Not to quote from personal experience and anguish. I used to be 6'6". I'm 5'6" now. I was nailed into the ground by doing musicals. Let me quote a famous anecdote told, attributed at least to Larry Gelbart, who wrote A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. One night at his house, so it is told, they were discussing whether Hitler was still alive. And Gelbart is alleged to have said, I don't know if Hitler is still alive or not, but if he is, I hope he's out of town with a musical.
Oh. Yes. Oh. It can be a joyful,
a
wonderful
than
experience.
Exactly, man.
Oh, I think it would be wonderful because the music takes you out of yourself. Yeah.
No way.
Oh, it's wonderful.
Well, you don't have to do a musical, but I'm getting ready. Lanford and I, let's do a musical.
Let's do.
Eric, some of the critics say you write for movies, you write with a cinematic touch instead of a literary touch.
That's a compliment.
I think it is. Do you think of movies when you're writing your books?
Can't help it, because I see actors in my mind when I
then you do think of the movies.
Absolutely, and it's not pejorative
at all. Does that take away from your literary talent?
I have a minimal literary talent. I have, as Noel Coward said, and I hope not to appropriate his wit, a slight talent to entertain, and that's it.
Can keep something moving.
That's a difficult
that's
thing.
That's a lot. Though.
That's a lot.
That's a nice
yes.
gift.
Oh, indeed.
Well, does a big fee that comes from selling a book to the motion pictures affect you when you're writing? Is that what's just uppermost in your mind?
No, not anymore. I've done
you're
it
so
twice.
You're so wealthy now. You're independently
I've done
wealthy.
It twice. So I read in the newspapers. I don't know if it's true. My accountant tells me I owe everybody, but it doesn't matter.
Including the accountant.
Indeed, him first. But the most important thing, and now with Man, Woman, and Child, it will not be a movie unless it'll be a little movie. Because the bigness of movies now, people in Hollywood are scared if they don't do big budget films. Mm-hmm. They're scared to do something small and gentle and tender. And yet whenever they do, whether it's Kramer versus Kramer or American Graffiti, it always comes up right, because people want to see about people, not exploding infernos, towering, and so on.
Breaking Away is a classic example of that. A very small, delightful little movie, low budgeted.
Well, you're in a position now, Shirley, where you can control the movie, and or at least control whom you sell it to and what the budget is going to be. And
this is all mythology. I'm glad you have these illusions about the movies. I'm glad you have all your illusions about the musical stage.
Keep your
illusions.
A man with no illusions.
There's one in every crowd.
I was just saying, there's got to
be blessed with the truth of your delusions.
We have to say goodbye at this moment, unfortunately, while he's raving on about illusions. First to actress Susan Strasberg, who has written the book about her life called Bittersweet. A very lovely actress, Alexis Smith, currently starring in the best little Whorehouse in Texas at the Schubert Theater. This is Earl Blackwell, an authority on celebrity and celebrityhood, and he also is a co-author of a book called Skyrocket. This is Erich Segal, one of the best-known authors of our day, famous professor at Dartmouth. Are you still teaching at Dartmouth before I go on?
Yes, sir.
And also his latest book is called Man, Woman, and Child. And this is Lanford Wilson, the most decorated and honored playwright of the day. Just won a Pulitzer Prize. His Tally's Folly won 5 nominations for the Tony Award. And the New York Drama Critics Circle Award is the best play of the year. Tally's Folly currently at the Studebaker Theater. Irv Kupcinet saying goodbye and see you next week, same time and same place.
Represent the best of England and Scotland. Just for the records, England wins 6-2.
The Royal
family has gathered for the christening of the baby son of the Duke and Duchess of Gloucester. Queen Elizabeth, Duchess and Tiny Prince and the Queen Mother. The Duke stands at the right of his brother, King George. At the christening, the baby is named Richard, a new royal personage, Prince Richard.
You're watching American Movie Classics.
Guys who caused me trouble got to get hurt.
That knife they stuck in was meant for me.